Welcome to Tempo Public Square. I'm Susan Kennedy.
And I'm Sam Torrance. Are you getting close to retirement? Getting close to the time when you'll draw on Social Security?
Or are you years from getting the government payout and wondering if you'll ever see all that money you're paying in?
Today we examine the insecurity of Social Security.
At what age should you retire? How much money will you get?
Will there be any money left when you need it?
Social Security, the process and the policy, right now on Tempo Public Square.
Support for Tempo Public Square is provided by the members of PBS 39 and by
building a workforce system called PA Career Link Lehigh Valley, training the workforce to meet employer hiring needs, connecting employers with workers, and workers with jobs. Lehigh Valley Workforce Investment Board.
Welcome back. What's the best age to retire if you want to reap the most benefits of Social Security?
Age 62, 65. What happens if you work until you're 70 or live well into your 90s? It all depends.
Depends in part on your ability to navigate the application process.
Tempo Public Square's Laura McHugh introduces us now to some retirees who help us figure out what's involved when it's time for you to find security with Social Security.
Rotate the whole arm so the palm is up.
The slow, methodic movements of the ancient Chinese art of Tai Chi reduce stress, and in Peg Steininger's case, help keep her young.
It gives you good balance, because when you get older, you're liable to lose your balance.
When Peg isn't working on her balance in class, she balances her budget at home.
I think it's just trying to be, have some smarts, so we say, in how you're spending what you have, and be sure you sort of have a budget for yourself.
Peg's one of 32 million retirees collecting almost $35 billion a year in Social Security benefits. She filed her claim at age 62, and 28 years later, at 90 years old, still relies on Social Security as her primary source of income, like many senior citizens. That means she really has to stretch every dollar.
Spread your toes wide. Lift your arches up and lift your inner ankles up.
Peg collects about $900 a month in Social Security, plus another $300 from interest and investments. Take out her utilities, health insurance, food, and other necessities, and there's usually little left in expendable income. Fortunately, Peg doesn't have a mortgage or rent and takes only a few prescriptions, so most of the time she makes ends meet.
Well, it's difficult, but I just do it. And of course, if I find that some expenses come up or the taxes come up that I don't have enough to cover that, I just go into my savings.
According to the Social Security Administration, today about one in every four 65-year-olds will live to be Peg's age, and one in 10 will live past age 95.
So you're talking about 20-some years that someone could be getting benefits. Of course, we see people getting benefits for maybe 30 years.
So how much will you need to make ends meet in retirement? It's a question 78 million Americans will ask themselves during the next 20 years.
These people that are reaching retirement age this year are filing for retirement and disability in record numbers. So it really is quite a challenge.
According to Eileen Levin-Dando, a technical expert in Bethlehem Social Security office, there's no easy answer as to when you're ready to retire.
It is a highly personal decision as to when to retire, depending on a person's cash needs, their health, their longevity, family longevity, what other retirement resources they might have, and of course how much their Social Security benefit's going to be.
While most people begin collecting as soon as they're eligible at age 62, plenty of others, like Rick Klotz, decide to wait a few years.
I had prepared myself financially that I didn't have to do that. And Social Security is a long-term benefit that I wanted to be able to maintain.
Even though he retired as Lehigh County Administrator in 2005, Rick continues to work part-time throughout the area. He waited until he turned 65 to begin collecting so that he could get more money in each check. Here, take a look at this graph. Let's say, for example, if you retired at 62, you would get $750 a month. For each year you wait to collect, your monthly benefit increases. If you start collecting at 66, the full retirement age, you'll access $1,000 a month. At age 70, you can get your maximum monthly benefit, in this case, $1,320.
The earlier a person starts receiving benefits, the smaller their benefit will be, but they'll receive it over a longer period of time. Whereas the later they start receiving benefits, the larger the benefit will be. Well, of course, it will be over a shorter period of time. But the total would be about the same.
To figure out how much you'll get in Social Security benefits, Eileen says to go online. According to Mark Basak, 1 million people have already filed for their benefits online, including Rick Klotz. He's among the 20% of local filers who decided to skip the Social Security office and file for their benefits from home.
You know, all that anxiety that people can get worked up about, I didn't have to worry about doing it right here from home.
Most online claims take about 15 to 30 minutes to file. Compare that to the 3 weeks it takes to get an appointment to file in person.
For me, time is money, even though I'm retired. I do cherish it, and it's a lot easier for me to go online and do as much as I can and then go to the person if I have to.
The point of this service is to give people a third channel. You can reach us in person, you can reach us over the telephone, and you can file online. And really, today, that's how folks like to operate. They like to have choices.
In February, Rick will receive his first Social Security payment, but he already has concerns for the future. Today, Social Security combined with his county pension is enough, but he worries how much he'll need to stretch if he lives another 30 years. For Tempo Public Square, I'm Laura McHugh reporting.
Thank you, Laura. That helps us get started on the process of applying for Social Security.
We'll give you some websites and phone numbers later in the show, which you can use to help figure out your personal benefits.
And to help us navigate further this topic of Social Security, Congressman Charlie Dent joins us. Welcome, Charlie.
Thanks, Susan and Sam. Thanks for having me on the show.
Thanks for being here.
Glad to have you here, Charlie.
Yeah.
I want to start out with a question. Do you think there's a problem with our Social Security trust fund and the benefits that we're going to be looking forward to getting?
Yes, there is a problem, and it is a demographic problem. I would also probably tell you that today we are not in a crisis, but if we do not address this problem, at some point there will be a crisis. And as time goes on, the options will be fewer and the choices more painful. But today, are we in a crisis? No. But we do have a real problem, and it is a demographic problem.
Well, there's
can
not.
Explain
ahead.
That a little bit further when you say the demographic problem.
Well, we have about 3.3 workers per retiree. That number will drop to about 2 or 2.1 workers per retiree, and so there are fewer workers supporting more retirees. And in 2008, the year that just ended, we saw something quite significant happen. The first baby boomers began to draw on Social Security.
So 2008, a lot of them out there.
Exactly, a critical year. In fact, and it's significant to the extent that in 2000, I think there were about 35 million Americans who are over 65. In 2035, that number will be about 72 million. So that population will more than double. As a percentage of the population, it will grow from 12% in 2000 to 20% in 2035.
Well, Charlie, I understand that aspect of the demographics, but also some of the things I've been reading has been there's money that's been paid in, and it's being used with other things, and there's earnings on that money that's been accumulating, but not really staying in the trust. It's
that's right.
Being used on other things. So
correct.
That goes beyond demographics. That goes beyond just the fiduciary responsibility of taking our money.
And there's not a pot of money waiting.
No, this is a pay-as-you-go system, and it is true that the Social Security system has been running surpluses in recent years, and those surpluses will continue, we expect, until about the year 2017, at which time we will begin to run deficits in the Social Security system. You should remember, too, that the last time there was a major Social Security reform was in 1983, and it was led by a man who wasn't so well known at the time, who was in charge of the Social Security Commission, named Alan Greenspan, and who later went on to become the Fed chairman. But it was Alan Greenspan.
Yeah.
And at that time, he and those commissioners made recommendations. They were enacting the law. President Reagan and Tip O'Neill were, worked this deal back then. And what happened then is essentially they said at the time that the system would continue to run surpluses until about the year 2020. Well, it's 2017 now, we believe.
Yeah.
And so they gave us, they bought us time,
right.
But
yeah.
The truth is Social Security is going to have to be looked at systemically, and it is true that those surpluses have been used for other purposes, but those surpluses are diminishing, and they will continue to diminish until 2017 when the lines cross.
How would you fix it? And something has to be done.
Well, of course, this is considered the third rail of American politics, Social Security. But I think we have to look at this in a very broad context, that when you look at entitlement spending, or what we call mandatory spending, those include three principal areas in the federal budget: Social Security, mm-hmm. Medicare, and Medicaid. There's some other areas, but those are the big three,
okay.
And they account for over about $1.1 trillion, I think, just between those three programs.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and so I think we're going to have to do to address this issue is to establish a commission. Now, I know you hear about commissions all the time, bipartisan commissions, but this one would be a little different.
Well, Charlie, tell us a little bit more about this commission, and how will it be different?
Yeah, sure. I know many people over the years have said, oh, it's just another bipartisan commission. They issue a report, sits on a shelf, lots of dust, and not much value. But this commission would be a bit different in that it would present a report, but would be binding. And I try to compare it to the BRAC Commission, or the Base Realignment and Closure Commission.
Okay.
We refer to it as BRAC. When military bases are closed, you go through this process about every 5 or 6 years where we make these recommendations.
Mm-hmm.
But essentially, the BRAC commissioners make their recommendations. It goes to Congress. Congress looks at it. The commission comes back again, issues a final report, and the Congress has to vote on this. On this report, up or down, no amendments.
Okay, no must have fiddling with it.
No fiddling
yes
with it.
Yes or no?
There's an opportunity for hearings and for review of the report, and then the commission can amend their own report,
okay.
But the Congress cannot amend the report, and that happens. And so the idea would be to provide cover to both the administration, essentially. When you have a new president, as we do in Barack Obama, this can help him.
Sure.
And basically gives him some political cover, because this is obviously a very sensitive political issue.
If you were ahead of that commission today, what changes would you make?
Well, there are a lot of things we have to look at, many things. And, you know, this is a big, complex system.
Okay,
we have to look at everything.
Okay.
Everything has to be on the table. First thing we should probably reassure people first that, you know, if you're over age 55, you're probably not going to have anything to worry about.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean, that's really not where the problem is. And we have to understand, too, that for most Americans, that Social Security really does represent the foundation of their retirement security. Hopefully, it's not the only source of income for most Americans'
that's
retirement,
key.
Mm-hmm. but it is the foundation for most Americans' retirement system. So, you know, we'd have to put all the sacred cows on the table. You know, we're going to have to look at tax rates. We're going to have to look at benefits. We're going to have to look at, deficits. Everything gets on the table, retirement ages and all that sort of thing. Everything gets put on the table.
Privatizing?
Like I said, everything will be open on the table. Now, I personally, I don't support privatization of Social Security, but I suspect there will be all sorts of ideas that are going to be thrown into the mix, at least for consideration.
Yeah.
And then they will review all this sort of thing. The commission will review all this sort of thing and then make a recommendation. And then there will be a vote up or down by Congress at some point.
And we're going to come back at the next half of the show and talk further. Lots more to talk about. So thanks for sharing these thoughts right now.
Sure.
And, of course, Charlie will be back in the next section.
But first, one person, one job, and one approaching retirement, all combined to get two incomes. We listen to his story next on Temple Public Square.
Each week here on Tempo Public Square, we examine one public policy issue, and of course today, we're tackling Social Security.
And to help personalize the issue, each week we have someone involved give us their own take on the topic.
It's a regular feature, and today we introduce you to Al, a baby boomer, who is looking to cash in after years of paying out to Social Security.
My name is Al Greinke, and this is my story. I'm 65 years old. Next month, I'm going to be 66. I'm a licensed professional engineer in the state of Pennsylvania, and I'm enrolled in the MBA program at DeSales University and hope to graduate at the end of this year. A month ago, I signed up for Social Security and for full payment at the age of 66 next month. Yet, I expect to work for at least 2 more years with my employer, F.L. Schmidt, in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. So, in essence, for 2 years, I'm going to be double dipping, drawing full salary and drawing my Social Security. Now, there's a couple of reasons why I chose to do this. One is that I've been paying into the system since 1961, and I've never missed a payment, so to speak. So therefore, I'd like to get some of the money out that I put in. Now, I understand that it doesn't quite work that way. However, psychologically, it works that way. I put the money in, I expect to get something out. Another reason is that I've been with the company for 28 years. I like my 30 years. I think it's a milestone. It's something to achieve, 28 years with one employer, and I really, really want that. Now, for a lot of younger people, this may not be important. They change jobs every few years. For me, it's important, it's significant, and I want to do it. Thank you very much, and this is my story.
Thanks for sharing your story, Al. Indeed, some say it's baby boomers such as he who may be the last ones able to cash in on these benefits.
That's right, Sam. And we welcome back Congressman Charlie Dent now to discuss further this changing face of Social Security.
Mm. And Charlie, I want to get back to privatization. I think there's a lot of confusions about privatization and Social Security. Can you help clear up some of those myths?
Oh, sure. First, I oppose privatization of Social Security. But what has been talked about in Congress in recent years, and you're going to hear a lot less talk about it, the notion of a voluntary personal retirement account or private accounts, those were always structured similar to the federal thrift. The idea is that those accounts would be structured similar to the thrift savings program, which is kind of like a 401k for federal workers, tightly regulated and controlled. It's not like you put the money into this account, you contribute this money to the account, and then basically you can take it out whenever you want. Now you can get an annuity at the end of the time. You can't take the money and go spend it in Vegas, for example. Yeah. It's not that simple. So I would tell you, though, that said, I don't believe voluntary personal accounts or private accounts are going to be on the table for discussion. President Obama has rejected them as an idea. So I think that's going to be pretty much of a non-starter in this debate. But I think what's important to focus on, though, is the fact that a lot of Americans, particularly younger Americans, don't have as much confidence in the Social Security system as they ought to. I think older Americans tend to be more confident in the system, about the system, than younger Americans.
It's not going to be there. I mean, that's the talk in our neighborhood. We're paying in, and we're not going to get any of it back.
Well, let's. It will be there. It will be there. let me explain what the reality is. I mentioned that 2008, the first boomers, the baby boomers, are collecting. 2017, that's when the deficits begin. And 2041 is when the system becomes insolvent. Okay. Now, if nothing happened, if Congress did absolutely nothing, in 2041, I believe Social Security would be able to pay somewhere around 78% of promised benefits. So if we did nothing, come 2041, when I'm 81, the system would be able to pay just under 80% of promised benefits. So that's
really? Because the way it's out there in the Treasury, and it's not really there. So then we have to borrow the trust fund. So we have to borrow, layman's terms here, Charlie, then I have to borrow $20 billion so that you can pay out till 2041, but you're borrowing $20 billion from me again.
From us, yes. That trust fund is out in Parkersburg, West Virginia, two filing cabinets. But I mean, I think that's part of what our debate here is, that it's important that we have a thoughtful discussion about Social Security before we start throwing out remedies, whether it's retirement ages or higher taxes or benefit cuts, whatever it is. We should not get into that conversation until we explain the facts of life to Americans. And again, if you're over 55, you have nothing to worry about.
Okay.
Yes. But this conversation really needs to include our children and our grandchildren.
I was going
to
say, because a lot of people, they might not worry about it themselves, but they do worry about it for their kids and their grandchildren.
And that's why everybody has to be engaged in the discussion. Even though it won't affect the over 55 population, they have an interest in this because it's about their children and grandchildren. So they have to be part of the discussion. And so we have to then explain the facts of life to let younger people know there will be Social Security benefits. It may be different at some point in the future than what your parents and grandparents have, because right now it used to be, I just don't recall when this was, but when many of the retirees first started claiming Social Security benefits, well, it only took about 2 years for them to recover all that they paid in. Think about that. So a lot of folks think, hey, I paid in, now I'm just getting my money back. Well, actually, you're getting more than your what you paid in, for most Americans. But over time, though, that will change. That those who are working today and paying into Social Security will take a much longer time for them to recover what they paid into the system.
And it still becomes
that way.
And it still becomes the fear of saying, will I even recover everything that I paid into?
Well, it depends how long you live.
Right. Well, the woman who's 90 and still alive and kicking.
I mean, going out many years, I mean, for that 90-year-old, I'm sure that that individual, basically was able to, and like all the 90-year-olds, was able to recover what they paid into the system fairly quickly.
Right.
But it will take much, much longer going forward. So that trend is going to change. So
right.
I think that's something we have to.
Charlie, are you optimistic that there can be a bipartisan solution to this?
Well, there will have to be. There will have to be. I mean, yeah, I am optimistic. Do I think anything is going to happen immediately? Probably not. Well, first, President Obama has to kind of let us know where he wants to go in this. As the president, he is going to have to make some difficult choices. This committee, this issue falls under the jurisdiction of the House Ways and Means Committee, chaired by Charlie Rangel of New York, and he's been a little bit distracted of late because of his own issues. And so this issue will require the full attention
sure.
of the chairman, as well as a considerable amount of effort from President Obama. And so I am optimistic that we can arrive at an agreement, but I don't think it's going to happen quickly.
But unless it's changed, Obama's take on this is, I'm just going to start adding more increased taxes to the higher ends, the higher income.
Right, right.
That's that solution.
But that fundamentally won't solve the problem.
Yes.
I mean, most of us who look at this issue know that just simply raising the cap
yeah.
from what I think in 2007 it was $97,500. Your Social Medicare,
yes.
by the way, that tax is not uncapped.
That's
but
right.
on Social Security, you're capped at $97,500 in wages.
Okay.
So over that, you
yes.
don't pay it. But remember that most wealthy people in America don't pay themselves in the form of wages, and this is a payroll tax. So you're not going to. It can buy you a few years of solvency.
Sure.
But it by no means will fix the problem.
Yeah.
I mean,
it
kicks the can down the road a couple of years,
yeah.
but it really doesn't solve this.
And that will come out in the wash with the commission or mm-hmm. some discussion.
Yes,
like
and that's something that will be discussed yeah. in the commission. But at the
yeah.
same time, there's an argument too. If you raise that tax rate, how is this going to affect the economy? And on
yes.
and on it goes. So, but that's an idea that the president has thrown out there. But I think that's not a comprehensive approach there.
Just
right.
very
yeah.
quickly, do you
Real
think
quick.
It'll be a priority?
Hard to say for the new president, maybe?
Yes.
Yeah.
Based on the campaign, I don't think so, but I think it will be forced on his agenda.
Yes.
At some point, given with the boomers retiring, I think he's going to have to come up with a proposal.
All right,
Charlie, thanks so much
Thank
for
you,
joining
Thank
us.
Thank you.
All righty. Now some thoughts from Tempo Public Square commentator Pam Varconi.
An ancient Chinese proverb that says, "May you live in interesting times," has never been more appropriate than in these times. Many of us in the baby boom generation have passed the point of philosophy and are now looking at stark reality. With retirement looming on the horizon, we're faced with some difficult choices, not the least of which is when to begin receiving Social Security benefits. Most retirement accounts and pension plans have been hit hard by the current financial crisis, making the decision about when to take our Social Security benefits even more important. If you choose the early option at 62, you're permanently locked into that amount unless or until your spouse passes away, at which time you may choose to receive benefits from their account if the amount would be higher. If you're one of those younger alphabet generations, X, Y, or Z, the math works differently because by the time you're thinking about retirement, the economy most likely will have recovered. In 1929, the last time the stock market lost 40% of its value, it took 25 years to return to pre-crash levels. So if you're under the age of 40, hang in there. If you're like my own children, you're not counting on Social Security at all. You're planning for a totally self-sufficient retirement, which is probably a wise decision. Can you imagine living on between $700 and $1,700 a month as your total income? By the time you pay for food, transportation, and taxes, there probably wouldn't be much left over. Social Security was never meant to be a retirement plan. The purpose was to provide a safety net against living the last years of our life in abject poverty. To see what Social Security will mean for your future, I highly recommend visiting the Social Security website, socialsecurity.gov. If you're someone who subscribes to the Ronald Reagan philosophy that the most terrifying thing you can hear is, "I'm from the government and I'm here to help you," you'll be pleasantly surprised by this comprehensive and easy to navigate site. It contains a wealth of information, including the ability to monitor your benefits while you're still working and actually file for them online when you do retire. In such interesting times as these, information is the power behind good decisions.
Thanks for your thoughts, Pam. Indeed, there are lots of resources to access regarding Social Security.
Whether you're approaching retirement or decades from it, you'll want to log on to our website where we'll link you to great sources of information.
Go to WLVT.org, click on Tempo, click on Temple Public Square and find the show titled Social Security.
There you'll find a link to the Social Security website. It's chock full of information, including a spot to plug in your stats to help estimate your benefits.
And on our website, you'll find a link to Congressman Dent's site that will get you contact information for county aging offices in Berks, Montgomery, Lehigh, and Northampton counties.
That's it for now, and join us next time when we talk to some area mayors to talk about their financial situation of their cities. That's right here next time on Tempo Public Square.
Support for Tempo Public Square is provided by the members of PBS 39 and by
building a workforce system called PA Career Link Lehigh Valley, training the workforce to meet employer hiring needs, connecting employers with workers, and workers with jobs. Lehigh Valley Workforce Investment Board.